Hi, thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for allowing me to come in at this time. I've been listening to the contributions this morning and or this afternoon, and I suppose we talked about words and words that we like and words that we're not such big fans of. For me, sometimes the word bullying doesn't really describe the extent of what we're facing sometimes, do you know? Like, as in, it doesn't seem to really capture the seriousness. Two of the contributions earlier mentioned, you know, how bullying leads to suicidal ideation. And you know, this is really the shocking horror of people going through this, the children going through it, families. I suppose in a lot of the presentations that we've had over the last number of committee meetings, you know, I suppose what I was trying to get to was, what does a good place look like? You know, what does a good school environment look like? What does a proactive engagement with parents and all other sort of leaders in the community look like? And I suppose if I could ask some of our speakers if they might like to give an example. I also think it was Professor Himmel, I think, that spoke about a play. I suppose in my mind, I really would have the idea that having role play in schools might be a way to let children know what to do if they are encountering a bullying incident or if they see it, if they're bystanders or upstanders, as well as the people who are perpetrating the bullying and the victims. As you've all mentioned, each of these groups suffer with the impacts and long-term impacts of not taking action. So I suppose if I could pose that question, just what was a perfect environment look like, and is there a place for role play or plays like that in our school system to help encourage, I suppose, identify the people to go to where people that students might trust, or just in general that it happens all the time and how to deal with it. Thank you very much.
I don't know if I can tell you what the ideal school, but I can tell you some examples of things. I think role play is important, but role play has to be done well. There's been some great success incorporating social emotional learning in drama. We've had people go in and work with students, so students have a voice in creating plays, creating activities that they do with younger children that do allow for those kinds of more intense working out of what you do in a certain situation. So for sure, there is a way to do that. But I also think that the more I see schools adopting social emotional learning, teachers really taking that to heart, having champions, like in our province, each school has counselors, and that's very separate from what they call a social emotional champion. And the social emotional people, for example, we meet every month with some representatives from several school districts that talk about, exchange ideas, whatever. We need time to talk and to exchange strategies, activities, and work together. So those things seem to be operating to begin to create those really well things. The other person thing that we've done that's been very effective is bibliographies. There are a lot of great books that you can use. So again, I love the diversity of approaches. Different teachers are going to feel different comfortable or uncomfortable with different approaches. But the more we can give them the capacity and the capital to do all sorts of different approaches, the more likely we'll reach some of those kids and create those environments.
Then, Carmel, or Paul.
Okay, I will focus especially because this is a very, very big question. I will focus especially on what an ideal SEL school would like, you know, or some examples of good practice. So I think where we need to start is to, as I said earlier, to foreground SEL. So socio-emotional education is not yet recognized in many countries, in many schools, in many regions as being important of value enough to spend our resources and to invest in its development. So many, many schools are, and maybe PISA doesn't help in this way, are still driven by a reductionist view of education based on cognitive learning, you know, so academic learning. So I think there needs to be more awareness on the importance of socio-emotional education as a crucial part of education, of human development. And then I think one way of doing this is when the whole school community mobilizes its resources, human, physical, to put this vision of socio-emotional education into practice across all systems. And I would start, so once, of course, we need to identify what are our needs, what are the needs of our students and our community. But we would start with training the adults in the school. Before we start working with the children on socio-emotional education, first we need to work with the adults, especially we start with the teachers, the school administration, so that they themselves, first of all, become converted, because some teachers and some parents are not convinced about socio-emotional education and its benefits, you know. So, but by doing it and by developing these competencies themselves, I think then they can serve as good role models for the whole school population. And as well, as we said, working with the parents, empowering them to educate themselves. So we have to be a bit careful here not to be patronizing, you know, and in a way blaming the parents in some way or another. As I said, we can organize, schools can organize the training with parents themselves leading. And then once we do that, while we have the whole school mobilized, its resources, we have a clear vision, we have trained the staff, and we have worked with the parents, we can start implementing socio-emotional education in the curriculum, extracurricular activities, in academic learning, in the classroom climate, in school bullying policies, you know, and then...
Because thank you very much, Professor Tabai. I think it's so true that it's engagement across all groups, schools and at home as well.
Senator, Dr. Downes is wanting to come in there just to reply to your question as well. Dr. Downes?
Sure, thank you.
Just to add to a number of the points, obviously working with the principal is a key aspect. You know, so professional development with principals are regarding social-emotional education. And we have restorative practice schools as well, where we have whole school approaches here. You know, we're not that far away from it in many of our schools. You know, there are a number of schools where you can see models of a real openness. You know, because conflict is not avoidable in schools. Conflict is part of life. So it's how those conflicts are mediated. Just to also emphasize a point that Carmel made there, just to amplify it further, which is that social emotional education is not opposed to academic learning. So that the research, international research, points out that social-emotional education improves academic learning because it involves a deeper engagement with the material, deeper connection to life experience, deeper processes of questioning. You know, for example, in English, if you're trying to understand characters' motivations in a novel, or empathy in history. Drama and role play is something which, is part of the primary curriculum and can be used as a method across subjects, such as in history or in religion or in ethics. You know, there are ways in which role play helps two key social emotional education goals, which are empathy and perspective taking. The other points in terms of ideal features of a school, you almost can sense it when you go into schools. You know, so one of my roles is to go around different schools on school placement, and you can see the tangible climate in the school where you see everyone, all the school staff are engaged with the school process. That they're happy to chat with the children. They talk at the level of the children. That, you know, so there's democracy in action in the school environment. So all of those whole school aspects. If you're asking me what other layers upon that, I've already argued for the whole school a committee to drive through change at a whole school level, not just one champion, but a committee, and the emotional counsellors, therapists on site. What I'd also add to that is a vision of a school as a lifelong learning centre, as a community lifelong learning centre, where the school is available after school hours. There can be after school activities that children want to stage it for, that maybe parents are engaged with. Also, the role of the arts here in bullying prevention and social emotional education is hugely underdeveloped. So there are many different multidimensional lenses there to build on. What I would also just say is that around secondary school level, a lot of the wider programmes have been shown to be less effective for older, teenagers. And there is a risk that overly didactic approaches will get the teenagers to react against it. So they'll do the opposite. So there's quite a lot of research, even going back to the 1970s, that if you try to kind of program, youth into things, that they will go the opposite way. So we have to be careful around that aspect also. So it's very much about, as the people are older, that you're co-constructing meaning-making material. In our report for the commission, we also emphasised how youth would have an input into curricular materials. And in the international research, one of the key features of successful bullying programmes were videos. So videos that were actively developed by minority groups and be victims of bullying to show what it's like in their life experience, so different minority voices to come through in videos is another dimension that the international research says it has a key impact for bullying prevention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Downs. And I know you've presented before us as well before, so thank you so much for your time on this. I suppose if I can just take away some key point there, then it would be that early intervention in primary school is crucial. So I know we heard from other schools talking about the Roots of Empathy program, which was really impressive on one of our other sessions. So I would take it that the focus on primary schools and early intervention would be absolutely crucial, along with obviously training the whole school and teachers within the whole school on these programs, and I suppose the emotional skills that you're talking about.
Yes, but I think I would also just emphasise that there needs to be a consistency then with the climate and culture of secondary school. So it's very important that those democratic voice-based principles at primary are carried through into the secondary school system, because you then risk a disillusionment if you have a very different type of school climate from primary to post-primary. So I would argue that we really need to be looking for that continuity of climate, and that would obviously go back to issues such as conflict resolution skills of secondary teachers as well as primary teachers in initial teacher education.
Thank you, and Caramagathan, and thanks, Chair, as well for the time. Okay.